Good day, fellow investors. The Financial Education Channel recently disclosed one of his portfolio, and I thought it would be interesting for me to make a review. I always love to look at portfolios. Before we start, let me just tell you that I really think Jeremy is doing a great thing for the general public investing mindset. He's leading a lot of people to invest in stocks, some money that they would probably spend on some crazy things. Also, without Jeremy, without seeing what he was doing on YouTube, probably there wouldn't be a Sven Karlin YouTube, because he really inspired me to do the same. So now let's analyze his portfolio that he recently disclosed to see, okay, what are the risks? What are the rewards? What is the investment strategy there? And I think I can really add value to all the people that might be following that or having similar portfolios. Let's start. What I figured out from his introduction is that this portfolio was created in 2018. So we knew he made more than 200,000 from his courses and YouTube video ads last year. That's very good from him. Really amazing. I make just 900 something per month from my YouTube ads. So thank you for watching. And just to note here, it's all donated to charity. The plan is to help earthquake hit Nepal by building new toilets for school, refurbishing classrooms. And I have just recently donated 3,000 euros, 3,000 something dollars to work on new projects in 2019. And you can read more about that on my website. And I hope to reach Jeremy's levels of 5,000, at least 5,000 per month, so that I can help more with these YouTube advertisements. Now let's dig into the positions. Apple, he says he didn't buy enough. That's easy to say a posteriori. It's always when something goes up, you're always sad that you didn't buy more. So he has just a small position. Apple, there are videos on my channel. It's a good company. Warren Buffett is invested. Yield, but a small position. Alibaba, his only direct investment in China, a 10% portfolio position. And here, I would say it all depends on growth. If the company grows faster than 30%, the current price is justified. If not, it isn't. So pure growth stock, depending on what's going on in China, how will their growth plans develop given the slowdown in China and the long-term expansion possibilities. So I see there are a lot of risk if the growth doesn't stay high. So a growth stock. Similarly, Cirrus Logic, audio and video related chips, highly competitive environment, supply chains, who will buy from whom, very interesting. I really will do a deep analysis of the 5G sector for a month. I will dedicate that to see whether we can take advantage of the sector. But it has a 10% free cash flow yield for now. However, revenues are slowing as the demand for these things is always elastic. So one should be careful there and see how this will work into the cycle, overproduction, oversupply or not. Earnings, corporate governance, I see a lot of GAAP and non-GAAP earnings. You can see here how the reported non-GAAP earnings are always much, much higher than the actual general accounting principles earnings. And this is something you have to really take care of, because they make money, then they issue stocks and then they buy back those stocks on the market. And that's a cost. Depreciation is also a cost, amortization, but they don't report it. So be careful with the earnings there. Callaway Golf, I analyzed that in some video somewhere about a year ago, and they were really in trouble in 2010. So one must keep in mind that sales of those products really crash in a recession. Golf is a sport in decline. So you are betting on the brand, higher sales from acquisitions, the mastodontic golf buildings that they are building, etc. So I would say very risky. Even, and the PE ratio and the cash flow yield is just around 6%, so not that high. Facebook, largest position, 25%. I agree with him on Facebook, the ads and their future runway, but Facebook is just a small position in my portfolio. Why not a larger position? Because of timing. Yes, Facebook ads are going to grow, but it takes time for Madison Avenue to switch to Facebook Avenue. So there might be a slowdown in actual revenue somewhere as the economy falters. You see what just a few scandals did to the stock. Think of what an actual hit would do. Really economic hit. So I'm a bit more conservative there, but more about this in later in the discussion on the strategy. Intuit is one of those great businesses like MasterCard or something, and I would say fully priced. The price to cash flow is 30, implying a 3% yield. The growth is slowish but stable, so the expectation there is that the company will continue to do buybacks, increase earnings per share, and that the market will keep the same valuation. It is possible. However, given that we are in an expansion of 10 years, I always see in these businesses, okay, what happens if there is a recession? So keep that in mind. And whether this company will be bigger in the 10 years, will be their new competition, etc. Similarly to Cyrus, Skyworks, connectivity chips, smartphones, 15% of the portfolio, same as Cyrus. Very interesting, but I have to dig deep into the 5G, see all the opportunities, see whether there is a margin of safety, because it's all about timing. 5G can be postponed by 1-2 years, and then these companies fall in value, fall in revenue, negative earnings perhaps, and then the stock price gets really, really hit. So you have to be ready to stomach that. Whirlpool, he says it's a dividend play of 3%. Okay, expanding Asia, buying more appliances. The company was hit hard because input costs were growing over the last year. But okay, a company, small position. US Steel, 10% position, price earnings ratio of 4. Here you have to analyze and understand the steel industry, very volatile, very difficult to invest in, and I'll discuss more about that in a tech mining company, which is also related to this, a little bit later. Now, I have three messages here. The first one is we have to understand Jeremy's investing style, which is different than many have. So he said this portfolio was built over 2018, so this portfolio is his investing available resources over just 1 year. He makes, we know, more than $1 million, more than $500,000, probably $1 million, who knows, and he can deploy that money into the stock market. So he's just buying, and if those stocks crash next year, he will simply buy more from more investment in income. So if you put this into a portfolio perspective, okay, my investment income, how much can I dedicate to stocks? Let's say it's 1,000 per month. And then yes, you can invest into Skyworks, Cyrus, Facebook, and all those stocks, because you know that next year in 2020, you will invest again 1,000 if those stocks are down. So that is from my perspective. His risk management strategy is from the income he will be getting more in the future. So it's not really a portfolio that is based on risk reward. The risk is managed through his income. That's something to keep in mind. And if you don't have investing income, then you should structure your portfolio much, much different. The second point is, okay, what happens to these stocks if the bullish thesis doesn't work out as planned? What happens if they don't sell much more chips, if there is a competitor? What happens if Apple cancels the contracts with them, they start doing their own? What happens if the price of the chips go down because there is a lot of competition? So small delays. So with the growth, what happens if the growth of Alibaba is not 30% but 20 or 15? And these are very important timing issues. So this is a portfolio, I would say, with a lot of timing into it. Yes, it will do great if you get the right timing, but you never know whether you have the right timing with such investments. So yes, stage it over a long term. Somewhere in the future you will be right because the tailwinds are there and everything, but you have to try to time it correctly or balance your investments correctly. Also, what happens when something doesn't work out? You simply open the 8th, 9th or 10th portfolio and you forget the first 3, 4, 5 portfolios that had big losers. And this is a very big investment danger, because then you are not really focusing rationally over your whole portfolio and investment performance. You're always starting new portfolios so that you forget about the bad performances in the past. That's a very easy behavioral finance investment trick to do, to forget about the bad and focus on the good. As Jeremy is focused really on the short term, all my positions are in green. It's about the business, it's about the earnings, it's about the growth there, not about what the stock did. So that's also something different that we simply differ from an investing perspective. I'm not saying it's bad, I'm just saying it's different. And that's something you have to also see. Am I going to invest in stocks or in businesses. And this makes a huge hell of a lot of difference when investing. Also, as I was saying about the portfolios, I have one portfolio where I add 1,000 per month, which is my growth portfolio. And then I have one lump sum portfolio that I'm building over this year, and that will be my 100,000K portfolio. And if next year I add, 50,000, it will be working like a fund. So I have, when I add the money, I have to deploy that money equally to a cash position and to all the other stocks in the portfolio. That's how a fund works. You cannot simply add money and then buy this, buy that or so. You have to deploy it equally to a lump sum portfolio, which is something that is very different from this constantly adding money, because it keeps you to balance the risks. You keep looking, okay, what can go wrong? And that's the final message. Always look with this, what can go wrong and how would that affect your portfolio? So thank you, Jeremy, for enhancing this YouTube. Very nice portfolio. And given his strategy and given his financial investments and income, I would say it's a good portfolio, because if it does work, he will make a lot of money. If it doesn't, he will simply buy more and make a lot of money down the road. So it's a growth investing strategy. If you have the income to sustain it, it will probably work really well. If you avoid the losers, the GoPros, etc., if you can do that, probably with his experience now, he will be able to do that. So I wish him all the best. Thank him again for inspiring me to do videos. Thank you for watching. Subscribe if you like this a little bit different counterbalancing investment strategy. And I'll see you in the next video.